Well, good morning, church. Great to see you this morning. I hope you all had a great Thanksgiving, and it is good to be here this weekend to worship together. If you're new to our church, welcome to Grace. We're so glad you're here. We do have a connections booth in the foyer that you may have seen. We'd love for you to stop by there. We have a gift we'd love to give you. Love to answer any questions you might have about our church. So please stop by before you leave today. A couple quick things to note. We do have a Lost and Found. It is out in the church library, which is right across from the women's restrooms, right out those doors. The Lost and Found, we are clearing that out. This will be the last Sunday before we take items to donate. So if you have anything you're missing and think, maybe I left it at church, be sure to check that today before you leave. And then lastly, the church library, we are going back to, if you want to check out a resource, going back to the paper cards, and that'll be up and running next week. You can start using all those resources there. And I think, if I remember right, there's some pretty great things for the Christmas season, so be sure to check that out. For everything else, let's roll our Grace News. Hey, middle schoolers and high schoolers, Christmas is upon us, and we will be having our Christmas party Tuesday, December 12th from 6:30 to 8:30 here at the church. Bring your friends along. It's going to be a great time.
This next Sunday, December 3rd, we're going to have our monthly prayer meeting, and our focus this month as we wrap up the year is on missions. We're praying for missionary boldness, partnerships in the gospel around the world, and for God to be supplying the needs of missionaries who are stationed all over the world. So that's gonna be our focus for our prayer time this month. Come join us. Instead of being at the church, we're actually gonna be at our house in Independence. So excited to have you all over. Bring kids if you want to. We're just gonna have a great time of worship and prayer. If you need our address, come find me or Jure. You can text me, call the church office, or find us on the directory. I think we'll also have the address put it up in the bulletins emailed out every week. All right, see you later.
Thank you so much for joining us this weekend. We are so glad to have you. Just a couple reminders, if you want to text in a question about anything we talked about today, there will be a telephone number on the screen during the sermon. It's an anonymous text line, so feel free to text any question in, and each week on our Weekend Debrief podcast, we'll be answering those questions. Also, if you want to contribute to the ministries of Grace Church, you can use the giving envelopes and put them in the donation boxes on your way out. We also have online giving, and you can also give to the Church Center app. Thank you so much for joining us. Have a great rest of your Sunday.
Well, good morning. Let's stand together as we start our time of worship today. I wanted to read out of Psalm 20. It's up on the screen. There it is. All right, it says, "May the Lord answer you when you are in distress. May the name of the God of Jacob protect you. May he send you help from the sanctuary and grant you support from Zion. May he remember all your sacrifices and accept your burnt offerings. May he give you the desire of your heart and make all your plans succeed. May we shout for joy over your victory and lift up our banner in the name of our God. May the Lord grant all your requests. Now this I know, the Lord gives victory to his anointed. He answers him from his heavenly sanctuary with the victorious power of his right hand." Let's read this together. "Some trust in chariots and some in horses, but we trust in the name of the Lord our God." So this morning we want to sing about that, that as we sing this song, just blessed be your name, that no matter what we're going through, we would choose to say, "God, we bless your name, we surrender all to you."
Found in the desert place, though I walk through every blessing.
Think about that, just blessing the name of the Lord, that right now in this moment we would just say, God, I surrender all to you. We think about, it says, worldly pleasures all forsaken. Take me, Jesus, take me now. That we surrender all those things. Savior, I surrender all. I give myself to thee, all to Jesus I surrender. And all to Jesus I surrender, Lord. I give myself to thee, fill me. Lord, let that be our prayer today. Jesus, as we hear from your word, God, that we would just be obedient to you. We love you. You deserve all the praise and worship. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's remain standing as April is going to read our passage today.
You can follow along in your Bible or on the screen as I read Ephesians 2, 1 through 10. And you were dead in your trespasses and sins, in which you previously lived according to the ways of this world, according to the ruler of the power of the air, the spirit now working in the disobedient. We too all previously lived among them in our fleshly desires, carrying out the inclinations of our flesh and thoughts. And we were by nature children under wrath, as the others were also. But God, who is rich in mercy, because of his great love that he had for us, made us alive with Christ, even though we were dead in trespasses. You are saved by grace. He also raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavens of Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might display the immeasurable riches of his grace through his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For you are saved by grace through God, through faith, and this is not for ourselves, it is God's gift. Not from works, so that no one can boast, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared ahead of time for us to do. Please pray with me. Lord, I just thank you that we can all be here this morning, and I pray that you open our hearts so that we can hear the words you want us to hear. And I pray that you'll be with Wes as he speaks this morning, and just give him the words that our hearts need to hear. In your precious son's name, amen.
All right. Thank you, April. Well, good morning to you, and if you're watching online, good morning. We're glad you're here today. Are you familiar with Yogi Berra? Not Yogi Bear, Yogi Berra. Yogi Berra was a famous baseball player. Spent his entire career in New York, Yankees, Mets, Dodgers. Yes, before they were in LA. And Yogi was known for his skills on the baseball field. He was also known for his yogiisms, which we'll talk about in a minute. But when he first came to a little bit about him, when he first came to New York, he was actually made fun of for the way that he looked and really criticized, saying he didn't fit the mold for a Yankee. And his response to that was, "I've never seen a baseball player hit the ball with their face." What difference does it make? Another yogiism, and we could probably finish this. It ain't over till it's. Yep, that came from Yogi Berra. Another one was, you get to a fork in the road, take it. Yeah. So he was famous for all sorts of sayings. One of them that we're going to talk about today that really fits in with our story is he said, it's like deja vu all over again. Yeah, and that's where we're at when we think about Abraham. And the title of today's message is Abraham, really? Yeah, it's like deja vu all over again. And we could probably think of situations in our life in patterns where this quote can apply. We fall into the same patterns, habits over and over again, and we're like, it's like deja vu all over again. Well, we know from our study with Abraham, he has this continual problem. And so what we want to do is just kind of give a high-level overview where we've been. Today is ending the section when we talk about the Father of Promise before we get into our Christmas season and talking about what comes next in Abraham's life. But just as we look back over Abram and Sarai, we know that they were promised great promises. Their descendants would be like the stars in the sky, that God would protect them. God had great things in store for them. And then Abram and Sarai went to Egypt, and as they were going into Egypt, what did Abram tell Sarai? Tell him that you're my sister. And Dave kind of spent some time talking about that and the reasons behind that. There was fear. And then we know that Abram rescues Lot. And then we see that there were covenants made and promises made. Before that, there was the Hagar debacle. Like, Abram, really? Like, what are you doing? Then there was Abraham's plea for the righteous when it came to Sodom and Gomorrah. We saw how the pull of the influence of culture, injustice, and then ultimate destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah. We spent some time talking about Lot and dangers of aligning ourselves with the culture. And we were challenged last week with Ryan and just looking at Lot. Are we a thermometer or are we a thermostat when it comes to the culture? And through all of this, we can begin to see the dots connecting of where God was at work. Despite all of the issues, despite all of the failures, we can begin to see where God was at work and that ultimately his plan is working out. And what we have seen in Genesis is God's providence, God at work. Now, I want to spend just a little bit of time because sometimes we hear that word and say, oh, it's providential or that's God's providence. Well, what does that really mean? And so it's such a key part of our text today that I want to spend a little bit of time just defining that. Commentator Martin Lloyd-Jones helps us to do that, and he starts off with first with us understanding that God is the creator of all things. I think we can safely say that in this room and online watching that's foundational, right? God is the creator of all things. And so Jones puts it this way. He said, we can put it like this. Creation means calling into existence something did not exist before. So providence means the continuation or the causing to continue of that which has been called into existence or guarantees their continuation in existence for the fulfillment of God's purposes. So those things that were created, us being created, the earth being created, all of those things, God just didn't stop with the creation. He just didn't go, wow, look at what I've done. And then sits back in heaven and just says, well, we'll just see what happens. Providence means that God is continuing or guaranteeing the continuation of the existence for everything that he has done to fulfill his ultimate purpose. The doctrine of providence does not just mean that God has a foreknowledge of what is going to happen, but is a description of his continuing activity of what he does in the world and what he has continued to do since he made the world at the very beginning. So sometimes people can think, well, God is so big God is not personally involved. He really doesn't care. He just creates everything and sits back. And we go through struggles in life, and we think God just doesn't care. What we see in the story of Abraham today, what we see throughout Scripture, is that God is a personal God. God is involved in our life. He has a purpose for our life, and he wants to continue to work through to carry out his plan in our life. And it's going to look different for each of us, but the fact is that God is a loving God. He is a caring God, and that's what we're going to see today. We're going to see this very thing, God's providence. Now, usually in messages here at Grace, we have a bottom line, right? We either get it at the beginning, middle, or end. And I'm going to give it to you right at the beginning, but I'm going to break the rules. You get two bottom lines today. You get a short version and a long version, okay? So get your pencils ready. The short version is, but God. But God, that is our short version of our bottom line today. We're going to see, as we heard in the text that was read this morning, but God, rich in his mercy. We're going to see but God moments in chapter 20. The longer version of our bottom line is this: God's providential plan brings glory to him and reminds his followers, that's us, those who place their faith in him, of his faithfulness, his love, grace, and mercy. God's providential plan, so his plan to continue to be involved with creation, to see his plan through, his providential plan brings ultimate glory to him and reminds his followers of his faithfulness, his love for us, his graciousness, and his mercy. God's providence. If you would, I'd like you to turn to Genesis chapter 20. Genesis chapter 20, it'll also be up on the screen if you want to follow along. But we're going to read verses 1 through 18, the entire chapter, because it's important for us to get the context of what's going on, because so much of the story and what we are going to talk about, it kind of jumps back and forth in how the dots connect. So chapter 20, starting in verse 1, it says this: "From there, Abraham traveled to the region of the Negev and settled between Kadesh and Shur. While he was staying in Gerar, Abraham said about his wife Sarah, 'She is my sister.' So King Abimelech of Gerar had Sarah brought to him. But God came to Abimelech in a dream by night and said to him, 'You were about to die because of the woman you have taken, for she is a married woman.' Now Abimelech had not approached her, so he said, 'Lord, would you destroy a nation even though it's innocent? Didn't he himself say to me, "She is my sister"? And she herself said, "He is my brother." I did this with a clear conscience and clean hands." Then God said to him in a dream, "Yes, I know that you did this with a clear conscience. I have also kept you from sinning against me. Therefore, I have not let you touch her. Now return the man's wife, for he is a prophet, and he will pray for you, and you will live. But if you do not return her, know that you will certainly die, you and all who are yours." Early in the morning, Abimelech got up, called his servants together, and personally told them all these things, and the men were terrified. Then Abimelech called Abraham in and said to him, "What have you done to us? How did I sin against you that you have brought such enormous guilt on me and on my kingdom? You have done things to me that should never have been done." Abimelech also asked Abraham, "What made you do this?" Abraham replied, "I thought, 'There is absolutely no fear of God in this place. They will kill me because of my wife. Besides, she really is my sister, the daughter of my father, though not the daughter of my mother, and she became my wife. So when God had me wander from my father's house, I said to her, 'Show your loyalty to me wherever we go, say about me, he's my brother.' Then Abimelech took flocks and herds and male and female slaves, gave them to Abraham, and returned his wife Sarah to him. Abimelech said, 'Look, my land is before you. Settle wherever you want.' And he said to Sarah, 'Look, I'm giving your brother 1,000 pieces of silver. It is a verification of your honor to all who are with you. You are fully vindicated. Then Abraham prayed to God, and God healed Abimelech, his wife, and his female slaves, so that they could bear children. For the Lord had completely closed all their wombs in Abimelech's household on account of Sarah, Abraham's wife. So it's a big chunk there. There's a lot for us to unpack. And so if you would, let's just pray and ask God to guide and direct us as we go through this passage today. Father, thank you for just your word. And thank you that you've given us the Holy Spirit to help us to understand what it is that we're reading. Lord, I pray that you would speak to our hearts and our minds this morning. And Lord, I just pray that that you would be honored and glorified today. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, there are several things, main things that we're going to see today. And the first one is this: but God sees our repeated failures. But God sees our repeated failures. We see this in verses 1 and 2. From there, Abraham traveled to the region of Negev and settled in Kadesh, or between Kadesh and Shur. While he was staying in Gerar, Abraham said to his wife, "She is my sister." So King Abimelech of Gerar had Sarah brought to him. We need to kind of set the stage or some questions as I was studying through this. Like, okay, so why was Abraham moving? Why is it, it says, from there Abraham traveled? Well, why did he move? What was the purpose of him moving? There are several reasons, just kind of searching through different commentaries and understanding that. It wasn't necessarily a sinful thing that he moved, although it probably wasn't the wisest thing that he did. But some of the reasons why he may have moved from one area to the next, where he was staying was an area that was plentiful for his animals. He was a shepherd. There was a lot of area that was like prime location. So one reason they could have moved is they were a nomadic lifestyle, and there was always competition for space. So he could have decided to move to have better grazing opportunities as more people were coming in. Another reason is that he could have chosen that he wanted to get away from the proximity of the events that just happened that we read about in chapters 18 and 19. Right? I mean, we couldn't blame him. Like, this is a pretty traumatic thing. Everything that has happened in chapters 18 and 19, like, I just need to get out of this place. That might have been a reason. It could be that he was continuing to sell all parts of Canaan, the promised land. He was still within the land that God had promised, although he was on the southern edge and kind of right on line. In fact, the area that he was in was under the heavy influence of Egypt. And so he was still within the land, but maybe that's what he was wanting to do, was to go out and continue to settle all parts of Canaan. We don't know exactly, but we do know that he moved. We know that Abraham had a lot of possessions. After the situation in Egypt, we're told that when he left, Abraham left very rich, is what the text says. He was very rich with livestock, with silver and gold. And it's important that we recognize as he left, all of those riches came from God. And that's going to be important for us to see throughout this text. His stay in Gerar, it tells us in verse 1, while he was staying there, it would indicate that this was not just a stopover visit. And we'll see that kind of flesh out later on in the text. But he was there for quite some time while staying there. So it wasn't just, we're stopping off, spend the night here. Remember, he had a whole entourage coming with him. So it wasn't like he could come in unseen, unnoticed. But his next move is where we see the deja vu all over again. Abraham said about his wife, Sarah, "She is my sister." So while in Gerar, "She is my sister." That is what he was told, or that's what he had Sarah say. That's what he said. And there's an assumption as readers that we would understand and be familiar with what happened in Egypt and why he is saying, "She is my sister." If we just read that, we'd be like, okay, that doesn't make a whole lot of sense. But we go back to what happened in Egypt. As he was moving into Egypt, the reason that he said, I want you to say that you are my sister is because of fear. It was driven out of fear. Because he said, I will surely die if they know that you're my wife. And so you should tell them this to save my life. There was a sense of fear, self-preservation. Abraham was not trusting in God to protect him. He was not trusting in God that he would come through and provide and fulfill his promises that we saw in chapter 12. Abraham and Sarah were headed down the same path. They were forgetting God. They were forgetting his promises, not once or twice, but repeatedly. So we saw with she is my sister, we see two accounts of that, but then we also see the whole Hagar debacle, right? He is taking things into his own hands, like, well, what was his excuse? My wife said that I could sleep with her. Like, Abraham, really? That doesn't work that way, right? God said he would give you offspring, and you took it upon yourself. That's not what God intended. So this was a repeated pattern for Abraham. It's not like Abraham and Sarah were oblivious to the promise. They knew what God had promised. They knew that he was going to give them descendants. They knew that they had been told that they would be protected, that those that were against him, against Abraham, that God would judge them. And so they knew this, but they still wanted to try and control things. Made me think of, have you ever been given a gift, maybe a promise of something, responsibility, and you held on to that thing so tightly that really that promise or that gift, that responsibility became secondary to your efforts to try and protect it. Like, you're given a gift, and it's a beautiful gift, and it sits on the shelf. It was intended to be used, but you don't use it, and no one can touch it. And you're going to do everything you can to protect that thing because it was a gift, and it was special, right? Sometimes that is what can happen. I was thinking about when I was learning to drive. And in Idaho, where I grew up, we got quite a bit of snow. And that was part of the thing, is you had to learn to drive in the snow. And so my dad had taken me out. I had a 1974 Chevy Nova, and it had some power to it, and it didn't have a lot of weight in the back end, and so it would do a really good job with cookies. That's another story. But as we're driving, and all of a sudden we're in deep snow, we're going down the road, and there's cars on either side, and I'm holding on to that steering wheel. I'm white-knuckling it. I'm holding on so tight that it actually starts affecting the way that I drive. And I remember my dad saying, you need to loosen your grip. And I think sometimes when we look at Abraham and Sarah, is they knew the promise that they had been given. They knew what God had told them, but they were holding on to that so tightly that they were forgetting. They were forgetting about the gift giver, and they were so focused on the gift. And they were trying to protect it. Sometimes we call that being a control freak, right? We probably all fallen into that. The definition, in case you were wondering, like, what's a control freak? A control freak is a person that has a strong need for control over people or situations. We could say that Abraham and Sarah were control freaks. They knew the promise, but they wanted to control how it was going to happen. But God sees our repeated failures. He saw their repeated failures. And just like Abraham and Sarah, we do hold on tightly and try to control our situations, our life, out of fear, just in case God doesn't come through. God promises Abraham and Sarah, but just in case he doesn't come through, maybe we should try and help God out. You know what? We're not too far off from Abraham and Sarah in our lives. This attitude really is sinful. At some level, we have fallen into this pattern where we put our trust in money. our money, the things we have, our possessions, are things that are given to us by God. But yet, we're like, okay, God, I trust you, but I'm going to hold on to this little nest egg here just in case. Maybe our health. We try so hard to do everything we can to be healthy, and yet, guess what? God is still in control of our bodies. Politics. We're getting ready to go through another season of this. And how much do we want to say we got to just have the right person or the right group in place, and once they're in there, then life will be good. It'll never be good. It doesn't matter. We can't put all of our hope and our faith in money, health, politics, careers. We can hold on so tightly that if I just have the right job, then life will be good. That's when we're taking control over the life that God has given us and the blessings. And it produces this deja vu all over again. So why this repetitive sin in Abraham? Why this repetitive sin in us? Well, one, we need to recognize that even though if you are a believer, you put your faith and your trust in Jesus, you still have a sinful nature. Romans 3:23 says, for all have sinned. And 1 John 1:8 says, if we say that we have no sin, we are deceiving ourselves. So if we come on a Sunday morning and or we're reading through the Bible and we go, man, Abraham, you are messed up. I'm sure glad I don't have those problems. I've never told anybody that my wife is my sister. That's not the main issue. The main issue is deeper, and we should recognize that we can't sit back with a pious attitude and our arms folded and go, I don't have those problems. If we say that we have no sin, we're deceiving ourselves. So that's one reason why we see repetitive sin. The other is we fail to deal with sin in our lives, and that causes this repeating pattern. We fail to deal with it. So how do we deal with it? Warren Wiersbe, the commentator, says this. He kind of encourages us in some things. This is not up on the screen, so I'll go slow so you can write it down. But the first thing is, how do we deal with sin? We need to admit it. Just simply admit that we have sinned, that what we did was wrong. We need to confess it. And that might be to confess to, well, number one, confess to God. But it might mean we need to have a trusted person that we can confess to that I have sinned. We need to judge it. Sometimes we can admit we did it, we can confess it, but we don't judge it. Meaning that we don't just come out and say, that was wrong. I shouldn't have done that. I need to judge it. And then the last thing is to forsake it. Forsake it means that is no longer part of my life. I am leaving that. I am going. That's the idea of repentance. Going one direction is not right. I'm repenting. I'm forsaking it. And I'm going a different direction. So we need to admit it, confess it, judge it, forsake it. So here are the passages that you can read later on that can help clear that up for you. Proverbs 28:13 talks about confessing and renouncing your sin. Proverbs 28:13, confessing and renouncing. Psalm 51:7 tells us how we should approach God. And it says we should approach God with a broken and humble heart. So in dealing with sin, we confess it to God. We should have a broken and humble heart, recognizing that we have sinned against God, our Creator. And then 1 John 1:9 tells us that if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just and will forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. The passage in 1 John is written to believers to remind us that He is faithful and just. When we confess our sins, He will forgive us. But God sees our repeated failures. How do we respond? We can ignore it or we deal with it. Let me encourage you, deal with it. God sees it. He knows it. We can't hide it from Him. Allow Him to do that work in you, to admit it, to confess, to judge it, to forsake it. And what we see in our story so far at this point, we're not seeing that happen with Abraham. God sees these repeated patterns. The second thing we see is, but God intervenes. God intervenes. Verse 3, but God came to Abimelech in a dream by night and said to him, you're about to die because of the woman you have taken, for she is married. Now Abimelech had not approached her, so he said, Lord, would you destroy a nation, even though it is innocent? Didn't he himself say to me, she is my sister, and she herself said, he is my brother? I did this with a clear conscience and clean hands. Then God said to him in a dream, yes, I know that you did this with a clear conscience, as I also kept you from sinning against me. Therefore, I have not let you touch her. Now return the man's wife, for he is a prophet, and he will pray for you, and you will live. But if you do not return her, know that you will certainly die, and you and all who are yours. Well, God intervenes in a very clear way to Abimelech. There is no doubt in this dream when God shows up and says, you're about to die. That would get his attention. This was not just Abimelech, but this you was you and all of your kingdom. It was you all are about to die because of what you did, Abimelech. The consequence was to the whole kingdom. And we will touch back to this. This is a connecting point to later on in the text of the effect of Abimelech. We're told in verse 4 that Abimelech had not approached her. In this culture, taking a wife into the harem would not necessarily mean an immediate sexual relationship. Many times this was for a political move, for status, because of the possessions or to gain power. And as we have already said and learned, that Abraham was very rich. He was coming with his entourage of all of his animals and all of the servants. And it was an opportunity for a pagan king to go, ah, this is a money grab. If I can get this and I can add it to my kingdom, how much more powerful will I be? And so a lot of times that would also be the big motivation. Commentators have also said that at this time, Sarah was in her upper 90s, and equivalent to today, he said that would, they said that Sarah would be somewhere around in her mid-50s. And God was preparing her to have a child. So commentators say she could still be very attractive, and there could be that motivation for King Abimelech as well. But all that to say, God was there to intervene. But God came to Abimelech in a dream. God was there to intervene, and Abimelech was showing more obedience than Abraham. It's interesting that the words that Abimelech uses in speaking with God, he says, Lord, would you destroy a nation even though it is innocent? Where have we heard that before? It wasn't that long ago that we had Abraham that was approaching God to say, would you destroy it if there are 50 righteous, if there are 40, if there were 5 righteous? Abimelech is using those same words to approach God. The integrity that is shown from Abimelech, a pagan king, is what Abraham should have been showing. Abraham's repeated failures and sins are seen by God, but God intervenes. Commentator Kit Hughes says this, we know in light of salvation history that God would not allow Abraham's lie to follow its inevitable course to tragedy. God had made an unconditional, no strings attached, unilateral, supersedes, it's for all, covenant with Abraham. And Abraham's faithlessness could not abrogate it. God had made an unconditional, no strings attached, unilateral, for all, covenant with Abraham. And even Abraham's faithlessness couldn't change that. God's intervention in this story allows us to be able to look ahead in the next chapter that Dave will be speaking on next week and in the continuing of the story to recognize there is no doubt about Isaac, the promised son, the son of Abraham. God's providential plan brings glory to him and reminds his followers and even this pagan king of God's faithfulness, his love, his grace, and his mercy. While these verses highlight Abimelech's fate if he does not return, Sarah, God makes a statement to Abimelech to show that he has not written off Abraham. And it's interesting. He says in verse 7, "For he is a prophet, and he will pray for you, and you will live." I don't know about you, but I read that, and if I was Abimelech, I'd be like, "Well, wait, what? Did you just see what he did? He lied to me. He put myself and my kingdom in danger, and you're threatening to kill me, and now you're telling me, but he's a prophet, and pray for you, and you will live." I don't know how that would sit. This is the first time that we see in Scripture the title of prophet that is used. Abraham speaks God's messages to the people. Abraham speaks of commands from God. He speaks the warnings of God. He speaks the judgments of God. And Abraham intercedes not only for God's chosen people, but he intercedes for this pagan king. Which is interesting as we look forward to history. It's a picture of the coming King Jesus. But God intervenes. Wiersbe, in his commentary on this passage, says, "Our position in Christ, justification, is not altered by our practice on earth, sanctification." And we see this in Abraham's life. So what he's saying is that our position in Christ, our position in Christ as believers, is that we have chosen to follow Jesus. We have put all of our faith, our hope in Jesus for salvation. We have been justified. We have been cleared. We have been declared not guilty before the King on our sins. Our sins have been forgiven. We've been declared not guilty. That's the justification. We've been justified before the King. That position in Christ, that love that God has for us, is not altered by our practice on earth, the sanctification, the growing in our relationship. And we see this in Abraham's life. This is hard to get our mind around, because we live in a world that says, if I just do more, maybe God will love me more. Or if I mess up, God's going to love me less. If I decide today that I want to give $1 million to church so we can complete the Yak Center, well, praise God for that. God's not going to love you anymore for it. If you leave the church parking lot and you cut somebody off and you get nasty with them, God's not going to love you any less because you sinned. We see this in Abraham's life. That's a hard thing for us to grasp, because everything in our mind says life is a works-based thing. We read that as April read the passage today. "For by grace you have been saved." It's not of our works, not of ourselves. It is by the grace of God that we have been saved. So even though Abraham failed and God had intervened to save Abraham and Sarah and his promise, what does God still call Abraham? His prophet, his mouthpiece. See, God did not excuse Abraham's sin, but he still said, "That's my guy. I have called him for a purpose." That is God's providence working in through Abraham despite his sin. We see that God and his continual work in Abraham's life and our life is to ultimately bring attention to God. ultimately to bring attention to show that he is the great and awesome God. And some might ask, well, if God will intervene like he did with Abraham, he'll come in and save the day like some superhero, does it really matter what I do then? I'm saved. I have a get-out-of-jail card right here. Does it matter? And the answer is, yeah, it does. We're told in Romans 6, 1 and 2, Paul says, what should we say then? Should we continue in sin so that grace may multiply? Absolutely not. How can we who died to sin still live in it? If we have a relationship with Jesus Christ, we're told we are not to continue to live in sin. We're not to continue to be in this pattern of deja vu. And to recognize that our sin has consequences. As believers, we've been forgiven from the penalty of sin. Jesus intervened. But God in his mercy will allow us to face the consequences, to help shape and to mold us, that sanctification process, to grow us our relationship with him and our reflection of him. So we're not off the hook. We may have been forgiven, and we don't have to pay the ultimate penalty for sin. But if we choose to sin, God in his mercy will allow us to face those consequences, to mold us and to shape us like him, and so that we can be a better reflection of him. God sees our repeated failures, but God intervenes. The next thing we see is that God confronts. Verses 8 through 13. Early in the morning, Abimelech got up. He called his servants together and personally told them all that he had heard, and the men were terrified. Then Abimelech called Abraham in and said to him, "What have you done to us? How did I sin against you that you have brought such enormous guilt on me and my kingdom? You have done things to me that should never be done." Abimelech asked this question of Abraham that we're all asking. What made you do this? Abraham replied, it's hard not to read in a little sheepishly reply, well I thought there's absolutely no fear of God in this place. Oh, this is sounding familiar. They will kill me because of my wife. Besides, she really is my sister. The daughter of my father, though, not the daughter of my mother, and she became my wife. So when God had me wander from my father's house, oh, Abraham, you're just digging a hole. I said to her, show your loyalty to me wherever we go, and say about me, he is my brother. Abimelech was confronted by God, and we see in this section that he responds with obedience. There was no doubt that God was talking to him, and he immediately called his servants, and he tells them of the dream, and how did they respond? They were terrified. Looking back to Egypt, why did Abraham and Sarah lie? Well, because there was no fear of God in this place, and we decided to take things into our own control. And they repeat this lie. They thought there was no fear of God in this place, and the response of this pagan king and his servants tell us otherwise. They knew enough about God to fear him, and they responded with obedience. Well, how did Abraham respond? Abimelech asked the questions that we want to know. Abimelech's response is showing concern for his people, and he's really taking the moral high ground. And he says, how could you do these things? A pagan king knows what Abraham did was wrong. And at this moment, Abimelech is showing to be more righteous in his response than the righteous Abraham. Let's be honest, Abraham's excuse is pathetic. Abraham's response showed a lack of fear. It showed a lack of awe of God. Instead of owning it, he's trying to excuse it and even blame God. So when God had me wander, God didn't make you go. Oh, Abraham, things are not going well for you. Commentator Donald Barnhouse said this, Abraham should have said, Forgive me, Abimelech, for dishonoring both you and my God. My selfish cowardice overwhelmed me, and I denied my God by fearing that he who called me could not take care of me. He is not as your gods of wood and stone. He is the God of glory. He is the living God, the creator, the most high God, possessor of heaven and earth. He told me he would be my shield and my exceeding great reward and supplier of all my needs. In sinning against him, I sinned against you. Forgive me, Abimelech. That's what we should have said. Kent Hughes says, both their lives, Abraham and Sarah, are ominous warnings to those in the train of faith, the church. That's us. It is entirely possible for the righteous, through their sins, to nullify their witness to the world permanently, as did Lot, or temporarily, as did Abraham. Those are tough words to hear. The consequences of our sin, how we respond to confrontation from both God and others, can determine how our witness is impacted. This is the reason Paul answers the question in Romans 6 the way he does. We must not continue to sin. It must be dealt with in our life, and the grace of God should never be an excuse to sin. From the beginning of the story, the whole thing is sad and wrong. But for Abraham to be confronted by a pagan king, one who has shown greater integrity and acting more righteously, this is a low point. Being confronted, really being humiliated. And at times, I'm sure we have all hit those low points as well, where we know we have sinned, where we've tried to come up with ways to excuse it, to shift it on someone else, or say, well, it's a situation, and this and that, and we can go, oh, it's just as pathetic excuse as what Abraham gave. We can hit those low points when the realization of our sin and the consequences seem to overwhelm us. And so the question is there hope? Is there any way forward? Is there any way to stop this cycle of deja vu? The answer is yes, but God. God's providential plan brings glory to him and reminds his followers of his faithfulness, his love, his grace, and his mercy. And one of the most exciting parts of this entire passage is this last part, and but God restores. God sees our failures, repeated failures. God intervenes. We see that God confronts, but God restores. Amen? Verses 14 through 18. Then Abimelech took flocks and herds and male and female slaves, gave them to Abraham, and returned his wife Sarah to him. Abimelech said, look, my land is before you. Settle wherever you want. And he said to Sarah, look, I'm giving your brother, not your husband, your brother, 1,000 pieces of silver. It is a verification of your honor to all who are with you. You are fully vindicated. Then Abraham prayed to God, and God healed Abimelech, his wife, and his female slaves so that they could bear children, for the Lord had completely closed all the wounds in Abimelech's household on account of Sarah, Abraham's wife. Abimelech's response was one of restoration and one of fear and reverence of the God of Abraham. Abimelech, what he was doing in essence was giving Abraham the bride price in animals and servants to try and pay back. The 1,000 silver pieces was a massive gift. It was above and beyond what was allowed. That 1,000 pieces of silver was equal to 160 years of pay for a laborer at this time. Do you think Abimelech got the message from God that he needed to make things right or he was going to die? He was going above and beyond. Abimelech was making sure that there was no question of Sarah's honor. There were no sexual relations between he and Sarah, and that would be important for us to recognize, to remember as we get into the next several chapters. This is Abraham prayed, and God healed Abimelech, his wife, and his female slaves so that they could bear children, for the Lord had completely closed the wombs in the household. A couple observations. One, Abraham prayed and God answered. It doesn't tell us in the text, but what we can infer is that Abraham dealt with his sin and repented. God answered his prayer. Abraham dealt with his sin. He recognized that what he had done, his lying, his taking control, was wrong, and he repented. And we know that, and one is that because God answered his prayer, and two, we don't see Abraham descend to this level of deception again. We have this repeated pattern up until this point of Abraham wanting to take control and do things his own way and to lie about his wife. We don't see Abraham descend to this level of deception again. So we can infer that Abraham dealt with it, just like we are called to deal with our sins to stop this pattern. God told Abimelech that his kingdom, that he and his kingdom were as good as dead. But what we see is that God healed him. There was no childbearing, no reproduction was the possibility. And so when Abraham, or when God had told Abimelech, you and your kingdom are going to die, how is that going to play out? You can't have any children throughout your entire kingdom. Your kingdom will not continue on. All the wombs have been closed up. So it kind of gives us an idea that Abraham and Sarah were there in Gerar for quite a long time, long enough for them to know that there was no possibility of children in the kingdom. God healed them. The question is, I struggle with this, like, okay, how can Abraham and Sarah receive such wealth and gifts from this pagan king, one whom they deceived? They messed up, and somehow they come out smelling like roses. Like, how does that happen? Well, one, we know that Abimelech got the message from God that he needed to make things right. But even more importantly, what we need to recognize is this is a picture of God's grace. Through God's providence, Abraham could not thwart God's plan, and God was still going to continue to use Abraham in a way that would be a blessing and honor to God. It was grace. It was unmerited favor. There was nothing that Abraham and Sarah did to earn it. And we can be harsh on Abraham and Sarah and go, that's not, how could they do that? How could they receive that? They don't deserve it. You're right. That's the picture of grace. Guess what? You and I don't deserve the gift that we were given in Jesus Christ. If someone was on the outside looking in going, man, you have messed up. I know you, and you don't deserve that. God says, I'm sending my son to die in your place to take that penalty. Unmerited favor, grace. When I read these verses, I think of the old hymn, Grace Greater Than Our Sin. It says, grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. But God restores. God's continued work in the lives of those he has created to bring about his purposes. That is, this is providence. What the story tells us is twofold. As a believer, God is at work in your life, whether you see it, whether you feel it, whether you even believe it. God is at work in your life because he is a personal God. He loves you. He has a plan for your life. His character speaks to his faithful work. This wasn't just for Abraham. It's for you as well. As a believer, you are never too far gone for God. Even if we are experiencing deja vu all over again, even if we find ourselves in the same patterns, there is grace, and his love for us is unchanged. Second thing the story tells us, that as a person who is on the outside of a relationship with God looking in, much like Abimelech. There is room for you to be a part of this family. This family that is made possible because of Jesus Christ. The cycle of sin, the repeated failures, the trying to be good enough does not have to continue. In Christ, there is hope, there is life, and there is joy. As we read earlier in the service from Ephesians 2, there is hope for all. But God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even though we were dead in trespasses. You are saved by grace. But God sees our repeat failures. But God intervenes. But God confronts. And ultimately, praise God, He restores. God's providential plan brings glory to Him and reminds His followers of His faithfulness, His love, His grace, and mercy. As we close, I think of the passage 2 Corinthians 9:15 that says, "Thanks be to God for His indescribable gift. His indescribable gift, His Son Jesus, His grace, His mercy." If you're here this morning and you don't have that relationship with Jesus Christ, if you're watching online, we would encourage you to talk to one of our prayer team members. We would love to be able to share with you how to begin this relationship with Jesus. If you're here this morning and you have that relationship with Jesus, but you're caught in this pattern, let me encourage you to do business with God today. Allow Him to work in your life. If you need to pray with someone, we're more than willing and desire to pray with you, to help walk with you in this process of growth and sanctification. As the worship team comes up, I'm going to close in prayer and we're going to continue our time of worship. Father, thank you that you are a gracious God. We thank you that even though we have repeated failures and sin in our life, Lord, you desire to restore us to a right relationship. And Lord, I pray that you would have space to work in our life, that we would give you that space to work in our life. Lord, you are a great and awesome God, and we give you all the honor, glory, and praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand as we respond to that message. We just realize that the victory, the battle is the Lord's, so we want to surrender that to Him today.
Thank you. You go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadow. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. An almighty fortress. You go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine. With my hands lifted high, oh God, the battle belongs to you. Let every fear I lay at your feet. I sing through the night, oh God, the battle belongs to you. When I will fight on my knees. With my hands lifted high, oh God, the battle belongs to you.
Every fear,
every fear, lay at your feet. I'll sing through the night. Oh God, battle belongs to you. Oh God, battle belongs to you. Oh God, battle belongs to you. The Lord, His mercy is more, stronger than darkness, new and more. The sins they are many, His mercy is more. He lavished on us. His blood was the payment. His life was the cost. We stood neath the debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many. His mercy is more.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. His mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, do evermore. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
His mercy,
is born. It's stronger than darkness. New every morn. My sins, they are many. His mercy is born.
Stronger than darkness.
Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more.
Amen. We want to end today with this song of this celebration that in the marvelous light and run out of darkness, out of shame, that it's through the cross that we can stand before a holy God.
Into marvelous light I'm running, out of darkness, out of shame. Through the cross you are the truth, you are the light, you are the way. Death has lost its sting. From the grave you raise up victoriously. Sin has lost its power. Death has lost its sting. From the grave you raise up victoriously. Into marvelous light I'm running. Darkness out of shame. Through the cross you are the truth. You are the light. You are the way. Into marvelous light I'm running. Out of darkness, out of shame. Through the cross you are the truth. You are the light. You are the way.
All right. Hey, what an awesome God we serve. But God, let's go with that confidence as we move forward that God intervenes. God desires a relationship with us, and he is not some distant God. He is personally involved in each of our lives. Go with that hope. Look for that person that needs to experience and needs to hear about that goodness of God's love. You are dismissed. Have a great rest of your Sunday. Know that you were loved.
Stuck in desert days, till mercy came and saved my heart.
As I said, like a lot of those songs I don't even play.
Right, yeah. Yeah.
You took my past and shattered it.
Awesome job.
Thank you.
Grace I don't deserve. You love me first. My soul will sing. Yeah. Are you faithful as a son?
When the rain you want is a flood instead, and the roses bloom, but they're not quite red. When I read the edge of my bravery, I still be singing at the banks of an imparted sea. Sometimes the only way through it is a hallelujah. Sometimes the only thing to do is just to hand it to you.
The only thing to do is just to hand it to you.
And though my troubles shake me, I know they could never hold you. Sometimes the only way through it is hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
The rain, so when it falls on me, should I complain or feel you calling me? It's all on me to say. I really catch what you're showing. It's my roots that you're growing.